I want you to hit me as hard as you can.
The term independent film has been corrupted over the years, with big-name talent making what they call small passion projects, with budgets of $5 million or more. But in the early 1990s, the term independent truly meant independent, with the likes of Richard Linklater and Robert Rodriguez shooting their inaugural films for under $25,000 each. Rodriguez even famously submitted himself to medical experiments in order to raise funds. And yet, it can be argued that no movie truly ignited the world of independent film quite like Kevin Smith's 1994 semi-autobiographical film, Clerks. How did this cult favorite take him from a minimum-wage working college dropout to the voice of a generation? Grab a Gatorade and some salsa while we find out what the fuck happened to this movie. The origin story of Clerks actually starts on a specific date, August 2nd, 1991. On Kevin Smith's 21st birthday, he went to see a film that he had been hearing a lot about, Richard Linklater's Slacker. Smith said that was the first time he realized movies didn't all have to be expensive stories about blowing up Death Stars. They could be smaller, more intimate snapshots of where you are in your life. This prompted him to enroll in the Vancouver Film School to fine-tune his filmmaking abilities. On his first day, he saw what he called a 90210-looking pretty boy and thought to himself, I hate this motherfucker. That person turned out to be his future longtime collaborator and best friend, Scott Mosier, who admits the first time he saw Smith, he judged him as just a fat guy in an oversized trench coat. One day, when they actually spoke, they realized they had more in common than they thought. It wasn't long before Smith came to the conclusion that film school just wasn't for him. Smith told Mosier that he could take his refunded tuition money and put it towards making his own movie, and he was heading back to New Jersey to write a script. Mosier was also writing a script of his own, so the pair agreed that whoever finished first would help the other make it. Once back in Jersey, Smith got his old job back at the Quick Stop, with one caveat. He asked if he could shoot a movie there in the off hours, to which the owners agreed. Smith spent time on a story set in a world he was all too familiar with, filled with characters that came from his real life. One of those characters was the off-the-wall Jason Mewes. Smith and Mewes first met as teenagers on a road trip to a comic convention with mutual friends. Mewes had called Shotgun to secure the front passenger seat, and as the other travelers couldn't stop laughing at Mewes' antics, Smith jealously sat in the back, thinking, he ain't so f***ing funny. Following that trip, Mewes began making unannounced visits to the home of Smith, who was not interested in hanging out, even explaining to Mewes that they had mutual friends, but that was the extent of their relationship. To which Mewes replied, cool, so yeah, what are we doing today? That childlike innocence, combined with a penchant for foul-mouthed rants, ultimately led Smith to create Jay and Silent Bob, the drug-dealing loiterers outside the Quick Stop and RST video store. When Mewes first saw the script, he was initially unsure he could do it, to which Smith said, it's all the shit you already do. The original script for Clerks was actually titled Inconvenience, and had a more David Lynch vibe, focusing on peculiar characters shopping in the overnight hours. A friend of Smith's suggested the title Rude Clerks, which eventually got shortened to just Clerks. Some devilish inspiration led to the final shooting script. It's a very loose retelling of The Divine Comedy, also known as Dante's Inferno, hence our lead character. The film features 9 scene headings throughout, meant to represent the 9 circles of hell. Smith sent the completed script to Scott Mosier, who loved the rapid-fire dialogue, and honored their agreement to come and assist making the film. Smith originally intended to play Randall, with another old friend as Dante. He held auditions at the local rec center where he had worked in high school. Smith had essentially already cast the lead roles with his friends, but was holding auditions for some of the smaller roles. But the people who came to audition were actual actors. Brian O'Halloran and Marilyn Gigliotti were local stage actors who blew Smith away, leading him to realize he needed experienced actors in the main roles. Jeff Anderson actually showed up at the rec center just out of curiosity, and he auditioned on a whim. But Smith immediately knew he had found his Randall, even though he had written the role for himself. Smith reshuffled the remaining cast and took the decidedly less demanding role of Silent Bob. He enlisted Dante's former flame at a local acting class after following Lisa Spoonhour to her car and asking, "This is going to sound weird, but would you like to be in a movie?" Her only reply was, "Not if it's a porno." And with that, Smith had found his Caitlin. With casting in place, it was time to fund his little passion project. And this is where the true independent spirit comes into the picture. Including the $5,000 he got from his returned film school tuition, Smith would sell off his entire comic book collection to boost the budget. and used a $3,000 check he got from FEMA for flood damage to his car and other valuables. He then maxed out every credit card to arrive at the final production budget of $27,575. Mosher and Smith used a Filmmaker magazine article as a guide to stretching a tiny budget. One such clever tactic was keeping the store shutters closed.
Someone jammed gum in the locks.
Bunch of savages in this town.
Which allowed them to shoot at night for a daytime setting. With Smith directing and Mosher producing, they still needed that ever-important person behind the camera, a director of photography. Smith originally saw a newspaper ad for local DP John Thomas, who had shot the film Metropolitan. Thomas could be hired for $1,000 a week with his full camera package, and Smith was willing to make the investment. But Mosher expressed concern that such an experienced person would take control of the film. Luckily, after Smith left film school, Mosher became friends with 19-year-old David Klein, a passionate, aspiring cinematographer, and he convinced Smith to give him a shot. Klein wasn't just behind the camera as DP, but got a few moments in front of it as well.
Ooh, Navy SEALs!
The black and white film started production in 1993, shooting 21 nights. The cast and crew would work their normal jobs during the day, then convene at the store every night at 11 and shoot until 6 in the morning, sneaking in some sleep whenever possible before repeating the cycle. Some actors ended up in multiple roles because people cast in bit parts just didn't show up. So Smith's close friend, Walt Flanagan, helped out using various disguises. Smith even called his mom at 2 in the morning to fill in when the milkmaid actor was a no-show. One sacrifice to the budget was the events of Julie Dwyer's funeral, which Smith had written but couldn't afford to shoot. The grim details were later revealed in comic format. Mosher and Smith used the RST video store as their personal editing suite, with film stock laying all over the place. Mosher has said that they were blessed by ignorance, because anyone on that set who knew what they were doing would have ruined the whole experience. With the film finally complete, it was time to get it in front of an audience. The first viewer was Smith's own mother, who, after watching the film, said, "You spent 27 grand on this piece of garbage? Good thing Smith doesn't hold a grudge." Smith had read a Village Voice article about how Richard Linklater got his film into the independent feature film marketplace. He followed those steps and actually got his film into that showcase with a Sunday 11 a.m. time slot. Smith and Mosher were ecstatic. All week long, they had seen lines of people outside the iconic Angelica Theater. They enthusiastically talked up their little movie to the waiting filmgoers, only to have the wind knocked out of their sails when someone mentioned that Sunday at 11 a.m. was actually the worst time slot. Sure enough, when their time came, the theater was practically empty. As his film played to so many unoccupied seats, Smith had a bit of a panic attack, thinking, "I'm f***ed, why did I think I could do this?" And yet, even if the premiere seemed like a massive failure, sometimes all it takes is a single person to change your life. For Smith and Mosher, that person was IFFM representative Bob Hawk, who had seen the Clerks brochure photo and thought it looked kind of pathetic, like someone's mother had taken it. Feeling sympathetic, he went to see the movie he knew nobody else was going to watch at 11 a.m. on a Sunday. Well, Hawk could not stop laughing during the screening and fell in love with the irreverent dialogue. After the screening, he called Amy Taubin, the writer for the Village Voice article that helped Smith get Clerks entered, and he told her she needed to see the film. Taubin got Smith's home phone number to acquire a copy, and his mom answered and replied, "You mean someone actually liked my son's movie?" Smith initially didn't believe it was actually Taubin on the phone, an anecdote she used in her piece on the film. Not long after, Smith received another phone call, this time from Peter Broderick, the writer of the Filmmaker magazine article about working with minuscule budgets. Broderick also happened to be the programmer of the New Directors New Films Festival at the Museum of Modern Art. When Smith asked Broderick how he heard about the movie, he was told it was Bob Hawk, an influential person in indie film who was telling everyone about Clerks. Smith got Hawk's number to call and thank him, only for Hawk to tell him that, although he was clearly inexperienced, Clerks was everything a film should be, calling it outsider art. Hawk then sent a copy to John Pearson, a producer's rep who was responsible for selling films to distributors and festivals. He had previously sold films like Slacker, Roger and Me, and Spike Lee's She's Gotta Have It. When the copy of Clerks arrived at his home, Pearson was out of town, but his wife decided to watch it. She called him and said that if he intended on leaving his job as a producer's rep, he should never watch Clerks because he would want to rep it. Pearson did watch the film, but he called Smith to say that even though it was a great movie, there was no real audience for it. For Smith, that was a death blow. He had made an enjoyable but unsellable film. His career was already over, and he had massive credit card debt. But the film stuck with Pearson, who eventually decided it was a film he had to help get in front of audiences. However, he did have one note. In the film's darker original ending, an armed assailant enters and kills Dante after he closes the store. Smith wrote that ending as a payoff to the phrase,
"I'm not even supposed to be here today."
The ultimate irony, being killed on your day off. Pearson suggested that the film simply end right as Dante closes the store. Through Pearson and the press pieces written by Amy Taubin, Clerks came to the attention of Mark Tusk, who worked in the acquisitions department of Miramax Studio. Tusk and co-worker John Gordon both fell in love with the film and rallied behind it, setting up a screening for Miramax head honcho Harvey Weinstein. But at the screening, Weinstein, an avid smoker, got up and left after the anti-smoking rant. He directed Tusk and Gordon to pass on the film. They both knew that was a mistake, but you can't go against the big boss. Smith and Mosher then submitted Clerks to the Sundance Film Festival at the behest of Bob Hawke, who was on the selections committee. Hawke championed the film to the rest of the committee, who weren't entirely sold on the potentially offensive material. But Hawke persisted, and the film was ultimately selected. Clerks had several screenings scheduled at Sundance, the first of which had many press members in attendance, but no distributors. After that first screening, the buzz began to build thanks to exuberant articles about the film, one calling it David Mamet meets Howard Stern. This word of mouth spread through the festival, and each screening was more packed than the last. By this point, Mark Tusk was even more determined to get the film picked up by Miramax. Using the positive press, he convinced Harvey Weinstein to see the film again, this time with an audience. The heavyweight producer agreed to give the film a second chance. At the final Sundance screening on January 28, 1994, Mark Tusk and John Gordon purposely sat Weinstein in the middle of a row so he would be unable to make an easy escape, and they told him he couldn't leave the screening until after he hears 37.
37. My girlfriend sucked 37 dicks.
In a row?
Kevin Smith would later recount that during this screening, he was getting annoyed by a loud, boisterous laugh all throughout the film, comparing it to Robert De Niro's infamous scene from Cape Fear. That laugh was coming from none other than Harvey Weinstein. At the end of the film, when Silent Bob gives his only line, it was originally meant to be spoken by Jay, but when it came time to film, Muse simply couldn't get the line out, thus giving way to the Silent Bob trait of only speaking when it matters. And at the screening, the entire theater erupted in loud cheers at this moment, and Weinstein looked at Tusk and Gordon and gave a thumbs up. They had permission to buy the movie. Directly after the film, Tusk, Gordon, and Weinstein met Smith and Mosher at the diner across the street, and over a plate of potato skins, Clerks sold to Miramax for $227,000, 10 times its budget. After acquiring the film, Miramax felt the soundtrack needed to be amped up with more alt-rock anthems from bands like Soul Asylum, Bad Religion, and Stabbing Westward. It was a rare case where the music licensing cost more than the actual budget of the film. Weinstein pushed for Clerks to be shown at that year's Cannes Film Festival. Although it was eventually accepted, it was so late that it was not featured in any of the film guides. And still, Smith would receive the Award of the Youth from the festival. Before Clerks could be officially released in theaters, it required an MPAA rating. Although the film features no violence and no on-screen sex or nudity, the MPAA found the profane language, including its 91 F-bombs, somehow warranted an NC-17 rating. But Weinstein hired famed O.J. Simpson defense attorney Alan Dershowitz to challenge the MPAA on the rating, and won the argument to earn an R with no cuts being made. Clerks received a limited theatrical release, never appearing on more than 100 screens at any given time, and yet it still managed to gross an impressive $3 million, 10 times Miramax's investment. Perhaps unsurprisingly, it was also a home video sensation, popping up on the shelves of countless video stores just like Randall's bothersome place of employment. Marvel may now be known for assembling a shared cinematic universe, but Kevin Smith beat them by more than a decade with the View Askewniverse, an interconnected series named for his production company. Clerks would spawn various comics, a short-lived animated series, and a never-aired pilot, and a return in 2006 with Clerks 2, catching up with Dante and Randall in their 30s. There was also a number of other related movies, which included roles for a pre-Oscar Ben Affleck, and a pair of live-action Jay and Silent Bob movies. With the recent revelations about Harvey Weinstein, Smith acknowledged that the powerful producer, quote, financed the first 14 years of my career, and now I know while I was profiting, others were in terrible pain. It makes me feel so ashamed. Smith vowed to donate all further residuals from his Miramax and Weinstein Company films to the nonprofit organization Women in Film. Clerks has gone down in history as one of the quintessential independent films, and was even selected for preservation in the Library of Congress National Film Registry, sitting alongside classics like All the President's Men, The Godfather, and Citizen Kane. It might not have launched Smith to the Hollywood A-list, but its success has inspired countless hopeful young filmmakers. In the years since Clerks was released, Kevin Smith himself has helped popularize the podcast format, written for comics and directed TV superheroes, produced a reality show set in his own comic shop, and stayed close to his independent roots. And thanks to his candid anecdotes, affable personality, and bottomless nerd knowledge, he remains a prominent face and voice in pop culture. And in one last bit of serendipity, on August 2nd, 2021, Kevin Smith's 51st birthday, and exactly 30 years after he saw Richard Linklater's Slacker, cameras would start rolling on the final installment in the Convenience trilogy, Clerks 3. Hard to believe it all started with ambitious intentions, a group of friends, a tiny budget, and a black-and-white movie about miserable, low-paying jobs.
You know what the real tragedy about all this is? I'm not even supposed to be here today!
Thank you for watching. If you like what you see, please subscribe to our Joe Blow Videos channel, tell your friends who like this sort of content, and turn on the bell to receive notifications for all our latest videos. We are an independent company, and we appreciate your support.